हाय, मैं हूँ श्रुति विद माय सेकंड नेचर. हैव यू बीन फीलिंग इट टू कि फेब जैसे ही शुरू होता है, सडनली यू नो ऑल दिस मंथ ऑफ लव, लव इज ऑल अराउंड अस, बट अंदर ही अंदर यू लाइक ओ माय गॉड, यू नो अब जितनी चीजें हम देखेंगे सडनली मेक्स अस रियलाइज इफ वी आर इन अ रिलेशनशिप स्टिल हाउ लोनली वी आर, और इफ वी आर नॉट इन अ रिलेशनशिप देन व्हाई आर वी नॉट इन अ रिलेशनशिप, और इफ एवरीथिंग इज गोइंग वेल, हम किसी ना किसी तरह से कोई ना कोई जरिया ढूंढ लेते हैं जस्ट टू फिगर आउट वन प्रॉब्लम इन आवर लाइफ विच इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड, बट व्हाई डू वी डू इट. सो आई थॉट इस महीने बहुत अच्छा आइडिया होगा कि क्यों ना मंथ ऑफ लव को हटा के हम इस महीने को कर दें मंथ ऑफ सेल्फ लव. सो इन केस यू मिस्ड द लास्ट पॉडकास्ट वेयर आई डिस्कस्ड राइट एट द बिगिनिंग ऑफ द मंथ अबाउट सेल्फ लव. Is it selfish? Is it self-love? What is the difference? Why do we need to dwell into self-love? Then the link is right here. Please do click on it. Click on it and listen to it. Listen to that podcast. Because aaj jo hum baat karne wale hain is a continuation of that. So today we're going to talk about loneliness. But nahin, akele main hi nahin yaar baat karti rahungi. Of course, we're going to talk to a specialist about it. बात करेंगे विद डॉक्टर रचना पाटनी. यू कैन चेक हर वेबसाइट आउट www.thecenterofme.com. सारी डिटेल्स आपको वहां पे पता लग जाएंगी. सो राइट नाउ लेट्स वेलकम हर एंड फर्स्ट लेट्स गेट इनटू द Q&A जो पिछले पॉडकास्ट के बाद इतने सारे सवाल आपने मुझसे भेजे हैं. इन केस यू आर वंडरिंग एक मिनट हाउ कैन वी गेट इन टच विद यू, वेल strongjad@gmail.com. मैं यहाँ पे नीचे राइट अप में डिस्क्रिप्शन में डिटेल्स लिख दूंगी, आप वहां पे मुझे मेल भेज सकते हैं. और ऑफकोर्स That's if you want to be personal. If you're okay questioning and putting forth your questions, यहीं पे नीचे in the comment section, please feel free to do that as well. Don't worry, आपके privacy का बहुत ख्याल रखा जाएगा. Dr. Rachna Patni, hello doctor, how are you?
Hello Shruti, I'm very well. How are you?
I am looking very smiley, but actually I'm not because I did the exercise that you asked us to do and band baj gayi uske baad a little bit. So, and I've been getting lots of questions also. So first we'll begin with a question and answer round little bit. So that, because I know ki agar mere zehen mein ye sawal aa rahe hain and there are a few other people who have messaged in, then for sure, more or less, many people will be experiencing this. So should I first ask you the first question for today?
Yes, first of all, let me say to you that I hear that ki band baja hai, and I want to reach out to you with the warmth of a witness, because ye kaam karne se there is always some kind of unearthing. Yes. So I want to acknowledge the reality of that. And I want to send you courage and love for doing this work, for you and for the other listeners who may or may not have written in. So thank you for just sharing ki it isn't easy. And there are many metaphors that many of my clients come up with for this work, right from it felt like transplantation or taking your roots out or, yeah, like I've already shared the bit about cleaning the garbage and now band bajna. So there are many metaphors and they are all very useful to make sense of what this experience is like.
Right.
So yes, I'll be very happy to get into a question that has come.
Yes.
And then we can take it from there.
So I'm going to just read out the question as is, the way it was sent to me, because, you know, I know that words matter and the way it's been written, it matters. So I've got a message in from Smriti. I did check with her. She was okay with her name being used, so which is why I'm using it. She's written in saying, okay, did the exercise. What next? Matlab figured out the childhood incidents in which I felt neglected. The adult self rationalized it away. But in reality, I can't go back in time and undo things. So ab kya apart from acceptance? Then she goes on to say, and then acceptance karne ke baad, how does it relate to my current relationship? Because when we are neglected in current relationship, then you see it as a pattern. You try again to rationalize it away. You again try and move on from that unfulfilling relationship, but the need is still there. The moving away is also very tiring. So this constant pattern loop, which she's talking about, which she's repeating constantly, even with doing the exercise and accepting that, okay, bachpan mein I felt neglected from my parents, but now what? How to apply it?
Okay, great. That's a, I mean, first of all, thank you to Smriti for reaching out with, you know, insights from her exercise. And I will be very honored to get into the detail a little bit. And I hope that my work here will reach her in the way that is my intention. So I'm feeling very moved that, you know, a listener has done the exercise and has reached out. Because this is my intention in this work, that it makes a real difference. And in the real world, it's like even one person who hears this and does this work, I feel part of their journey. And I feel this is really the most important work in the world, which is about being able to claim ourselves fully so that we can be fully alive in the here and the now. So when we think of helplessness, you know, or this feeling of neglect, you know, when we think of the kinds of things that can happen in childhood and you think of it theoretically, there's a lot of things like, you know, they can be physical abuse, they can be mental abuse, they can be emotional abuse, there can be neglect. And sometimes neglect can have more damaging long-term impact than physical abuse or emotional abuse. Because when there is abuse, you can clearly have like this relationship of the perpetrator of the abuse and you as the receiver of it. And then you can work on what it means to not be a victim anymore. But when it is neglect, then it is harder to get to the place of acknowledging that your needs were not met. Because it is not very clear. You don't have like a clear indication of, you know, someone was against you in a way.
Yeah.
And what it could do at a deeper level is create a sense of this feeling of worthlessness.
Yeah.
And it can make self-love extremely difficult because you may feel that you're not worthy of being loved by others and by yourself.
Right.
And this worthlessness can come up in so many aspects of life, you know, right from the decisions you make about how you eat, how you dress up, how you make time for yourself, for your needs.
Right.
You know, so it can really make you continue to put your own needs aside. Because you may experience life in a way that you're not worthy of making your needs central, letting your needs take the center stage. So in terms of changing patterns, what is the most difficult often is to make that change in yourself to say, hey, I'm going to be center stage in my own life.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And that can completely shift the terrain of your relationships. So instead of repeating the patterns, you will create a new imagery, a new set of relationships where the reciprocity of whoever is the other in your relationship. So it begins with you being the other when you engage in self-love. So you say, right, I'm relating to myself. What am I doing for myself that values my existence? What am I doing for myself that honors my life?
Right.
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 And how am I doing it? And how else could I do it? So that is one level. And then it, you know, it could be simple things like many people who have been at the receiving end of neglect may find that they don't have a way of making their own plans. Somebody else will make a plan and they will go along with it. And this can be quite intensive. It can be at every level.
Can it be the because opposite people, as well? Like when you overcompensate it, and you make sure that you make all the plans, like does it go that way as well?
It could. So, but it could still be from that sense of worthlessness.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And that you're trying to gain control because you feel so out of control.
Correct.
Because you feel so worthless.
Yeah.
And you assume that people are not going to value what is of importance to you, and people are not going to value you as important. So you begin to call the shots. But again, it is like when you go deeper down, it is that sense of I'm not worthy of real affection. I'm not worthy of someone really valuing my existence just for what I am and who I am.
So how do we change that, like you said?
Yeah. So firstly, the change has to come from noticing what are the relationships in which I engage with this worthlessness. Is it in every one of my relationships?
Hmm.
And the chances are it could be.
Right.
But there might also be people in your life who sort of encourage you to stop doing that to yourself, you know? And it may not come in a very conscious way.
Hmm.
But there might be people who are telling you, hey, why don't you make a plan today?
Hmm.
You know, why don't you tell me what you want to do?
Hmm.
Like, why do I always have to be the one to say, I want to do this on a holiday, or I want to eat this?
Yeah.
You know, when you go to a restaurant and you're like, I want to order this. So I want you to know what you want to eat. I don't want to be the one ordering for you all the time.
Right.
Now, this kind of a pattern could happen. And then, you know, it's up to you to say, hey, this is happening because I never consider my own choices, my own agenda as being worthwhile.
Yeah.
And I'm going to start doing that little practice.
Right.
Because people who have been neglected often have no confidence in their choices for themselves and for life or whatever.
Right.
Now, if it has gone the other way where there's too much controlling happening.
Yeah. Or to compensate, one is coming across as somebody who's very in control, takes decisions, and they've built themselves up like that. But deep down within self, they have the, you know, the same issues that you're talking about.
Hmm. So for that, it becomes a little harder to get to it, because the more our behaviors are protected by defenses.
Yeah.
You know, like in my work, I often say, you have to let go of your defenses. You have to come without an armor.
Right.
You have to become aware of all the shields that you're carrying.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So people who are very committed to their defensive personality, they will find various ways of never really reaching that core of knowing that they are feeling worthless. You know,
right.
And they might have really extreme ways of being in control. So they might be doing a lot of physical exercise, you know, building the muscle, which prevents. So I'm going to get a bit technical here, but really muscular, doing a lot of bodybuilding and all that. So the feelings don't actually get to you, because internally you're armoring yourself from your feelings.
Or you can come across rude. Like in a lot of cases, I think I've seen people do that as well. They just put this thing of like, oh, I am untouchable. You cannot talk to me. I will be rude and I will just be like the strong person. So not approachable, basically.
Yes. Now, often when it is neglect at the core of it, it may not necessarily lead to this kind of thing.
Right.
But there are various other abusive patterns people may experience in childhood, which may create that toughness.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And one may be like when you as a child have been made to feel that you are extremely important.
Okay.
You know.
Yeah.
And that you know, pardon me for using this phrase, but literally that the sun shines from your bum. There are children who are brought up like that.
Center of everyone's universe. Yes.
Yes. Huh. You know, and that is another kind of relationship that can be damaging, in the sense that the child could then get used to their needs being met at the expense of everybody else.
Right. Right.
And it may create like a different kind of persona, you know. Right. But if we stay with this example of people who are from this exercise, when you have concluded that what Correct. You've experienced is like this, that you're rationalizing other people's neglect of you,
yeah.
then it may have to do with you never feeling completely accepted by the parental couple.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
So it may be even a sense of what is called Oedipal conflict, right? Okay. But we yeah. don't need to get technical like that.
Yeah.
But it is a sense that you are the third person.
Right.
You are the pylon.
Hmm.
Okay.
Hmm.
That there is no place for you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when you start acknowledging that, one, you may have been given a message that you are not worthwhile other people's time and energy, or that there are other tensions and pressures which are making you always the last on the list, so you're never a priority.
Right, right.
So you may become used to doing that to yourself.
Ah,
okay.
Yes.
And over time, this will build like a person who never prioritizes themselves, who is constantly kind of putting their needs on the side,
right.
and therefore also becoming less of who they are. So in relationships, they may experience that people find them a little absent
hmm.
because they are not fully engaging in life, you know, they have become constricted.
Hmm.
So right from like conversations to enjoyment of food or enjoyment of environment or, you know, like fulfillment in your sexual life. In everything, it becomes more about like what is required of me,
yeah.
rather than what is my experience. What is required by me is constantly put on the side, and what is required of me is constantly brought center stage. So to change that pattern, you know, for a bit, you may end up being like the kind of person you don't want to be.
Yeah.
But, you know, you'll start with the blundering and start with saying, right, I don't want that.
Yeah.
I don't want to eat that.
Yeah.
I don't want to wake up right now.
Right.
I want to have a bath. I don't want to have a bath. I'm not going to do anything because somebody else wants it out of me.
Right.
You know, and let me give myself like 7 days of only doing things when I have that feeling or that impulse of wanting to do it.
Right.
So that may reset certain things,
Correct.
You know, but the great reset always requires this time out from what is regular,
yeah.
because your regular life is fully determined by the patterns,
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
And in fact, a lot of people in your regular life will be most affected when you change your pattern.
Hmm.
So, hey,
you might
know,
lose
get
a lot
them
of people.
Used to it.
yeah.
Yeah. And you know, it's a good old clear out.
Yeah.
But there might be those who want to continue in your life.
Yeah.
And whom you wish to have in your journey.
Hmm.
And then it's very good to have this conversation with them that, you know, I'm trying to change some foundational things about me.
Yeah.
And you may experience that I'm being different from how you're used to.
Hmm.
And I would love to know how it challenges our relationship where you are concerned.
Right.
But I really need to do this for myself,
right.
because it's time.
Right, right. I absolutely
you
agree.
Know? Yeah. So maybe they want to start off like this,
yeah.
and then try it out for 7 days,
hmm.
and then see what is the experience of prioritizing yourself.
And
this
then
is
give
a way
us the
of
feedback,
really
because
giving...
that's really important. So that
yes.
people know what is going
yes.
on, right? Yeah.
So really giving yourself at a deep level
yeah.
the message
hmm.
that you are worthy of the life that you want to create.
Good.
And that your existence is beautiful, meaningful, significant
hmm.
and substantial.
Wow. So So from this, we're going to move on to one more example, and purely as an example, so that, because I know, like I said earlier, that a lot of us experience things and they are common things we experience. Uniquely, our situations can be different, but we experience very common things, right? So when I did the exercise, one pattern that kept emerging for me was protection. Like, you know, I constantly felt the need to protect my parents, to protect my relations around me. And that pattern kind of still goes. So I don't know. I'm pretty sure many people go through that pattern. So what is your insight on that?
So feeling protective of those who are actually supposed to take care of us,
right,
could happen, you know, for two kinds of reasons. Of course, I mean, you know, human stories are so complex that, you know, I could go on into making it finer.
True.
But just to give you, like, at a basic level.
Yeah.
So you may actually be feeling protective towards a caregiver because they don't have the capacity. Like, you know, and this can often happen when we have parents who may be in, you know, in some sort of an abusive context.
Yeah.
Either they are abusing alcohol or they are in a relationship which is abusive, or they have a mental health problem, which means that they are not constantly able to be coherent in their relationship with you. Yeah. As a child.
Yeah.
Now, the other way in which we may be protective, we may feel that we are protecting our parents from something. But it may actually be that we are also protecting ourselves from their anger. So we don't want to be real about what's happening in our life. So, you know, like, let's say if a child has a nail that goes into their foot and they come home and they don't want to share it with a parent.
Yeah.
On the one hand, it is because they may feel that, oh, my mother is not going to be able to deal with this, you know.
Yeah.
But they may also feel that my mother's going to, like, freak out and panic and scream and shout at me.
Yeah.
And get angry about it. And I'm not going to be able to deal with this.
Yeah. Yeah.
And at a further deeper level, they may feel that I'm hurt and injured. And actually what I really would like is a mother who can just care for me and take me to the doctor and get me a tetanus shot. But instead, I'm going to have, like, an angry mother. And I am really angry with her for that. And I don't know what I might do to her because I'm so angry with her. Okay.
So I'm going to punish her by not telling her. Yeah. We're also trying to keep it a little light. Yes. Yeah.
Yes. So you take it deeper and deeper and deeper.
Yeah.
Then actually what you have is you're protecting your parent from your own anger.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So why is that? Because your anger feels so huge that you feel it's going to destroy everything.
Correct.
Now, little babies feel rage when their needs are frustrated.
Really?
And of course, yes.
One would and think that baby looks so cute rage. And cuddly. Yeah, sorry.
No. Yeah. So, you know, and often in India, people say, oh, isko to bahut gussa aata hai. And I keep saying, which baby is it who doesn't experience anger? It's one of the basic emotions, you know.
True.
So, we need to normalize anger and rage in babies. It's really important to do that.
Right.
And what happens to a baby is like your whole body experiences it because you don't have any defensive structures.
So
your
true.
Muscles and bones are still growing. So your whole being experiences a full flurry of anger. Because when I did the first exercise of where are you feeling, what you're feeling and all that, when you grow up, you kind of localize things.
So if you're wondering which exercise, I'm going to put the link right here. You can click that and listen to that episode.
Yeah. Okay, great. So for babies, it's like their whole being feels it.
Yeah.
And because it is so threatening to feel that much anger, but at the same time, the baby is also feeling dependency on the parent and love for the parent, right?
Right.
So most of the thing about becoming an adult, as far as, say, my journey is concerned,
yeah,
and I think for, you know, at the risk of kind of making a generalization, it is about being able to interweave the love and the hate and accept a person.
Right.
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 So when we ignore the hatred, then actually we are not able to truly love.
Yeah.
So that's when people say love and hate are two sides of the same coin.
Correct.
The way I experience it is when we acknowledge all the hatred that we may have felt towards those that we also love.
Right.
Then you can have a love that is not, being pulled down by unacknowledged hatred.
Right. So that rage which you're talking about, which we can't feel at our core, we should just accept that and say that's part of love. That exists, therefore I can also love that much. Right? That's what...
Yes, but also we may not need to just accept it.
Right.
We may need to express it.
Right.
And we may not express it to the person, because actually that person may have changed a lot.
Right.
But it's this relationship that you are carrying inside of you. You know, in psychology, they call it object relations. But it's that, for example, you may feel a lot of rage towards your mother. You know, I'm just using it as an example.
Yeah, usually everybody feels a lot of rage towards their mother. All the blame goes on the mother.
So, the chances are that whatever rage and all you're feeling, if you don't get it out of your system, you will keep experiencing it at the littlest of triggers. You know,
yes.
The whole thing will come up again and again, like a, like a dragon that's not been tamed.
Right.
So when you acknowledge that the anger that you're feeling is of a mother who is no longer your mother, because that mother was experienced by you when you had like limited capabilities, but now you are different, but the mother is still the same in your object relationship.
In the head, yeah.
What is being triggered is an old relationship.
Right.
Because, you know, even your mother may have changed. She may have grown up. She may have realized how limited she was, or how young she was, how clueless she was, how hormonal she was, how unprepared she was, you know, all these things.
Correct.
So all of those are the rational things. And I don't want you to go there and forgive the mother now.
Right.
I want you to stay with what the baby is feeling, all the rage, all the disgust, all the hatred, and you let it out. So you may want to do this, like, some people find kickboxing quite useful.
Yeah.
Really physically, like, taking it out of your system. And I can't advocate some of these exercises on your own, because sometimes it can get very intense, and you do need a holding environment. But in many of my individual work, actually I end up being that person who enables the expression of something that has been blocked.
Correct.
Because when it is blocked, that's when all the other things also get blocked, because the channel of the feelings are the same.
Correct. Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So when you're blocking your hatred, when you're blocking your aggression, when you're blocking your anger, wo pipe to wahi hai. So usme the clogging is happening, you know. So you need to release that to enable the full sense of joy, the full sense of vitality to come through you.
Right.
You know, we don't have a separate emotional pipe for anger and a separate one for joy.
Correct.
And a separate one for love. They're all using the same channel in us.
How beautiful. Yeah. Lovely. So
yeah.
I also feel that before we carry forward and we discuss any further, any new emotion, I think this question and answer round for us has been so meaningful that I think we just need to absorb all of this for today. And in the next episode, we shall go forward and discuss more details of what next this month of self-love is going to bring to us. And so that there you can give us a new exercise, and then we can bring up the question answer round again. So I think this as a pattern is a great one.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can keep doing like part A.
Sure.
And part B.
I think the questions have really, what the questions have led me to is the different ways in which we may begin to feel quite alone in our journey.
Very true.
Of life.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Either through anger or through neglect, or through different forms of abusive patterns that we have not cleared out, we may begin to live life like an island, you know, like I have to meet my own needs, or I have to have a fortress, or I have to not be center stage. So whatever it is, you know, there are like different forms of loneliness,
right?
Because they prevent an organic relationship with what is around you.
So
I do feel that, you know, talking about loneliness in the next session would be a nice progression. But I didn't want to cut short my engagement with the questions that came up today. So I didn't want to rush into that, but I see it as a natural progression.
I absolutely agree with you. So if you're wondering that, oh, but we wanted to know about loneliness, don't worry. That's going to be a very quick episode upload very, very soon. So you will get to hear all about it. Meanwhile, after listening to this session, if you're thinking, I have a ton of questions now. So, well, you can, of course, connect with Dr. Rachna Patni on www.thecenterofme.com. But alternatively, Doctor, there's also a Facebook page where they can connect with you, right?
Yes, so I have this small group called the Head and Heart Lounge. And the idea is that it's for the emotional and the intelligent folks out there who want to hold both aspects of themselves together. So, you know, I'd be very pleased to receive applications for membership into that group because I'm trying to create a vibrant community there where people are truthful about their feelings.
How wonderful.
And about their growing capabilities.
So I'm going to write the link down below. I'm going to give it in the description. So in case you're interested, you can definitely, you know, check it out from there and then reach out. So that will be supremely wonderful. I think today I'm also going to do that. First thing I'm going to do is after the session, go and join in over there because I want to be that person who's in touch with her emotions and with that good balance as you're suggesting. So that sounds wonderful. So great. On that note, we are going to say bye-bye, but we shall soon see you very, very soon discussing loneliness in this month of self-love. So thank you. And thank you, Doctor, for your amazing insight as usual.
Thank you, Shruti. I'm glad that you find it useful. Thank you.